Okay, last, we have on the agenda, local bill by Representative Perry, 1325. Representative Perry, you're welcome to explain your bill when you're ready. Make sure your mic's on, Representative.
Very good. Sorry. Thank you, Mr. Chair. This is a local bill dealing with the Gainesville Region of Utilities. What it does, it's pretty simple. If this were to pass, it would put a referendum vote to the city voters to decide whether or not they wanted to have the Board of Directors of Gainesville Region Utilities remain as a city commission, or for the city commission to appoint an independent board to manage Gainesville Region Utilities. This is a second stop. The first stop, we had a unanimous vote in favor of it. And that is the bill, and I do have amendments too, sir.
Okay, before we get into the amendments, are there any questions on the bill? Okay, go ahead and explain your First Amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This clarifies the qualification for voting members to be appointed by the city commission.
Rep. Perry, having explained the bill, are there any questions on Amendment Number 1? Or explain the amendment? Seeing no questions or debate. Seeing no debate, you are welcome to close on your bill.
Wait, close.
On the amendment, excuse me. Having closed on the amendment, are there any objections to the amendment? Seeing no objections, show the amendment adopted. You recognize to explain Amendment Number 2.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Amendment 2 clarifies the provisions of the bill related to suspension and removal of members of the new Utilities Commission.
Are there questions for Rep. Perry on the Amendment Number 2? Representative Dudley with the question.
And now, I'm not sure if I've got this right, but Representative Perry, are members only precluded if they have a second degree felony? Is that accurate?
You recognize?
No, there are other provisions that would preclude them as well.
Okay, well, let me follow up. Rephrase that. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So, but that's part of it. So they would have to have am I reading that right? Second degree felony? As part of a, that would be one of the issues that they have to be disqualified?
Mr. Chair?
You recognize and understand these are questions on the amendment we just adopted, but you recognize to answer.
Okay, you're talking about, well, just to answer the question. Yeah, there's a series of issues that would pre-qualify or disqualify someone who was either to be appointed or one that was serving. And we try to follow a lot of guidelines in just regular state law and other examples.
For follow-up.
Thank you. I'm just curious, second degree felony is punished by up to 15 years in prison. How that got picked as the standard.
You recognize?
Well, we tried to look at different models of what other commissions do and did not do, and so we looked at those. If you've got ideas and suggestions, certainly would be willing to look at those if you thought things need to be included or excluded.
Representative Goodson with a question.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Representative, I would like to ask you, if a second degree felon gets you removed, would a first degree felon keep you on the board?
And we are talking we're talking about the amendment.
Yes, I am.
The one we're on now. Yes. You're recognized.
Yeah, I think we need to look in the context of the rest of the bill as well. I believe it was first degree felony. There's a list of different issues that would both pre-qualify you from being appointed and a list of issues that would subject you to removal.
Any other questions on Amendment Number 2? Seeing no questions, is there debate on Amendment Number 2? Seeing no debate, is there objection to Amendment Number 2? Seeing no objections, show the amendment adopted. You recognize to explain Amendment Number 3.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Amendment three clarifies that a member of the Utilities Commission who seeks a waiver of the Code of Ethics to be adopted by the commission under the bill may not participate in deliberations or vote on that waiver request.
Are there questions for Rep. Perry on amendment number three? Representative Williams?
Can you repeat that? I didn't catch it all day.
You're recognized.
Thank you. The amendment clarifies that a member of the Utilities Commission who seeks a waiver from the Code of Ethics, which will be adopted by the commission under this bill, may not participate in deliberations or vote on that waiver request. So the person who was requesting that waiver cannot debate nor participate in that vote.
Any other questions? Is there debate? Any objections on the amendment? Seeing no objections, show the amendment adopted. We're on amendment number four. You're recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Amendment four, this amendment eliminates a provision that would authorize the new Utilities Commission to impair existing contracts.
Any questions on amendment number four? Any debate on amendment number four? Is there objection to the amendment? Seeing no objections, show the amendment adopted. We are now back on the bill as adopted. Are there any questions for Rep. Perry on the bill as adopted? Representative Goodson.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Representative, I just want to make sure I understand that this is the way I read the bill. If you go to line item 60, it says you would have a minimum four-year bachelorette degree of accredited institution, major area study, technical business, accounting, law, and other similar fields of experience. And as a business owner or partner or an officer of a business, sales exceeding $5 million annually. That is the qualifications to serve on your board, correct?
You're recognized.
If I heard you right, the amendment clarifies either or.
Okay. Follow up?
Follow up.
If that be the case and you qualify everything and you're a real estate agent and your business goes from $5 million to $4 million, would you be removed from the board?
You're recognized.
There are reports that you would need to be filled out on an annual basis that would subject you for removal, yes.
Follow up.
In Alachua, could you tell us or do you know how many people have small businesses that make over $5 million a year?
You're recognized.
In gross sales?
I wouldn't have any idea on the number, but I know there's quite a few that do that in gross sales. So if you want to know the intent, I could get into that with you, but I wouldn't know the number of that.
All right.
My business would, but some wouldn't.
Representative Raywinkle-Bassolina for a question.
Thank you, Chair. My first question is, did your whole delegation, are they unanimous on this bill?
You're recognized.
It was a 3-to-1 vote.
Thank you. I have another question,
follow-up.
Chair. Thank you. Lines 467 through 473, I guess, around there. How do you anticipate that section being used? In other words, and also, is there anything else like this in statute? In other words, asking for relief from a code of ethics. I think that kind of concerns me.
You're recognized.
Thank you. I don't have an answer for you on that particular thing. I know that it was when we looked at other models around the state, JEA, Lakeland, some of the other independent utility, which most of the larger utilities, all the larger utilities are run by an independent board. So what we did is we looked at other models and took a lot of the information they had in their charters and used that to develop this one.
Vice Chair Bashirs with the question.
Thank you, Chairman. Representative, real quick, I heard you say that the county approved it, correct, 3-to-1?
You're recognized.
Yes, the county, the local delegation, yes.
Okay, and one follow-up?
Follow-up.
And one follow-up, I'm just curious, what's the genesis of the bill? Who brought you this bill?
You're recognized.
Over the last few years, we've had the highest rates, or recently the highest rates of electricity in the state of Florida. So it's been multiple years of many groups that have brought it for me, lots of individual constituents, namely one, my wife, every month when she opens a utility bill, was a big promoter of this. So it has really been a literally hundreds and hundreds of people that have come to me from both sides of the aisle that have expressed interest in having something done to help alleviate some of the potential problems and the highest utility rates in the state of Florida.
Ranking Member Dudley with the question.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Representative Perry, I'm focusing on this a little bit. I thought my eyes were deceiving me, but it's there in the black and white or the black and yellow. Apparently, now we are allowing convicted felons to serve on the board, and the only way you can be disqualified is if that felony is a second-degree felony. I'm thinking that person with a third-degree felony conviction, doesn't even have the right to vote anymore. So why do you want him on your board?
You're recognized.
Yeah, and we stayed up pretty late trying to work out all these amendments and get them done. And certainly, if those are valid arguments, we can bring those up. You have to remember, though, this board is appointed by the city commission. So certainly, we would want to have limitations and expectations. The city may decide or not decide who is qualified, at least in that regard, who they would appoint. So they're not limited. This doesn't limit that they would have to appoint somebody in that circumstance you're mentioning. But I certainly understand your question, and I think that's a valid point to look at, and I will be doing that.
Representative Fullwood with a question.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. To Rep. Perry, a couple things. You just mentioned to Rep. Bashir that the county voted 3-1. Is that the county commission, or were we talking about your Alachua delegation voted 3-1?
You're recognized.
No, the Alachua delegation.
Okay.
Not the county.
You follow up.
And if I may, thank you, Mr. Chair. The city council voted as well. What was the city council vote on?
You're recognized.
Yeah, the city council, and I'm sure you're going to hear from some of them, that was a vote opposing this bill.
Okay. And just
follow up.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. One last follow up. I know we had talked, and I think most voters would agree that no one likes paying high utility rates. But this creates a board that regulates electrical and wastewater broadband. It creates a utility board versus just an electrical board, if I'm not mistaken.
You're recognized.
That is correct.
And just one last follow-up, Mr. Chair. So if our issue is electrical, should we just create an electrical board and leave the wastewater and the other utilities separate? Was that a consideration when you were looking at crafting the bill?
You're recognized.
We looked at Gainesville Regional Utilities and all that they encompass, and which did do the wastewater treatment and water and others. We did take out a couple of provisions where they were responsible for collecting garbage fees and stuff like that was outside of what Gainesville Regional Utilities should be doing. But we didn't break it out. We looked at it as a whole, and we looked at it, again, we tried to model it after some other utilities around the state, and it right now it operates as different divisions under one umbrella. And so we thought we would keep it in that same structure and didn't want to we didn't want to make this where this was a wholesale change in how the governing structure was done. Just simply to have the goal is to let the voters decide, but the goal is to let the voters decide whether or not they want people who are focused singularly on running this utility, which does have its multiple divisions, but that would be where they would focus versus all the other things that a city commission now. This utility, I think if I'm not mistaken, is $470-some million enterprise. It's not a small utility. And so that's why the initiative to bring this forward, to have an independent board that focused on this utility and hopefully have some guide, you know, give it some both long-term stability and have the GRU commission or the people who work for GRU deal with a set of people. Right now with 7 city commissioners, every year and a half you get a new city commissioner. And so the board, the GRU staff have to bring someone up to speed. Every year and a half you have a new member potentially. So that was the idea and the focus, longer terms, less people, 5 member, and hopefully have a focus on that they could provide the services that the constituents expect.
And we're back. Rep. Goodson, full circle, back around.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Do you know of any time that the state has written a charter for a local government other than this one? Usually, local governments write a charter, a local bill comes up. But I was curious, have we done this before?
You're recognized.
Thank you, sir. I'm not aware of the history of that or not.
Representative Dudley. Ranking Member Dudley.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Representative Perry, the word plenary is used throughout the bill to describe the new commission's authority. Does this mean they never, ever have to consult the city commissioners?
You recognize.
No, but we did want to have them autonomous to a certain degree. We did not want to have the political forces the city appoints, just as, you know, the governor may appoint a judge, but certainly once you appoint somebody to do a job, there should be expectations that interference would be limited by the people who did the appointing. And that's truly what we want to do, is have an independent board. So no, there is oversight. The city commission, again, is the appointing board to this independent board. And there's opportunity. We did limit in the first draft, we did limit the amount of times that a city commission could request information in meetings. We took that out. So now the city commission has the opportunity on a regular basis, if needed, to address the commission and ask for information. And now there are certain times they have to provide certain information to the city commission.
Okay, seeing no other questions, we have quite a few appearance cards, so we'll get those started. If I butcher your name, please just correct me when you come up. But we'll start with Yvonne Henson Rawls from the city of Gainesville. You're recognized.
Good afternoon. Imagine my fear from being first.
Commissioner, it is. Sorry about that.
Thank you.
Thanks for being here, Commissioner.
Mr. Chair, I am Yvonne Henson Rawls. I am a city commissioner for District 1 in the city of Gainesville. District 1 is on the east side of town. Most of you will know where I'm talking about. I thank you for this opportunity to speak for my citizens today. I oppose this bill on many levels, the most important of which is the independent commission. We have two examples of independent commissions that have not served us well, in my opinion, my humble opinion. One of them is our airport authority. Now, our airport authority is operating quite efficiently. However, the citizens have no, and we own it, the city of Gainesville owns it, but we have no authority or voice in their decision making. In fact, we own land around the airport that we want to do some economic development with right now, and we're having trouble figuring out who do we, the city, go to make this decision. How do we manipulate the sales, the marketing, and other activities in order to develop the land that we own around the airport? That's one independent commission that we have. We have another independent commission that has been disbanded. It was organized to run Alachua General Hospital, which was owned by the citizens of the city of Gainesville. That independent board decided to sell our property where all of our descendants died, and all of our ancestors died, and many of our descendants were born. They sold this property for a dollar. I'm almost in tears about that. And our citizens had no voice in that decision because they were independent. My third problem with this is how we got here. How a specific few discontents could get this far over the influence of people who were elected by the citizens of Gainesville. We all oppose this bill. It's unanimous. And by the way, let me correct another fact. The Alachua delegation voted 2-1. There was one of the delegation members not present. So it was 2-1. One member was absent. Now, I do agree we could use some restructuring. We're working on that, and we've been working on that about a year. We have already implemented many changes that were recommended by our Chamber of Commerce. Please allow us to continue this work. I believe we will have something in place by the end of the fiscal year, and if you demand it, I know we will. We are looking at two proposals that I believe is faring well that I recommended to my colleagues. One is an advisory council of experts who will get all of our issues taken to them first, and they will vote on a recommendation to send to the commission. And the second structure we're looking at is what I fondly call the Lakeland model, where we will have a combination of city commissioners and citizens who represent the different rate structures, business structures, and locales. And let me get to the elephant in the room, the rates. Surely the biomass contract has led to us having high rates, but that is not the only reason. Our conservation efforts, and we're big on conservations in Gainesville, has led to a decline in sales. So we have kind of conserved our way out of our own sales. So our sales are down while the biomass contract is up. And I ask you to please consider opposing this bill. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner, for being here and for your time today. We do appreciate it. Up next, we have Nicole Shaley with the City of Gainesville, Gainesville City Attorney. She's an opponent of the bill. You're recognized.
Thank you, Chair and members of the Subcommittee. I am Nicole Shaley, the City Attorney for the City of Gainesville. I've been a municipal law attorney for over 11 years. For the record, I'm certified by the Florida Bar as an expert in city, county, and local government law. And when I attended law school here at FSU, I worked for this House of Representatives as a staff analyst. I appreciate you all giving me the opportunity to come here today and share with you my legal analysis of the bill. And I hope that you'll come to the same conclusion that I have, that whatever issues you might believe are facing Gainesville Regional Utilities, this bill is not a good solution, and in fact, it creates more problems than it will resolve. Before I get started, I want you to sort of understand the context of why this bill is so significant to the City of Gainesville. First, the city has been a leader in the provision of municipal utility services to its residents. We started over 100 years ago by providing water and wastewater. In fact, coincidentally, today is UF Day at the Capitol, and in 1905, our water system and our promise of service to the university is why they came to Gainesville. Owning and controlling your own utility system has allowed the city to do two things primarily. Obviously, the first is enabling it to attract and retain economic development and development in general. And the second is it's provided the city with a diversified revenue source. And this is of particular importance in Gainesville because we are in the unique position of only having 40% of our property taxable or on the tax roll. When I approached the legal analysis to this bill, I did it just the way I do for my client, which is first I try to understand what's the problems that it's trying to solve. Does it solve those? And if not, what would? As you've heard from our commissioner, our city commission does hear routinely from a group of citizens, and we've also heard from the chamber and others, that there's a concern with three things: high rates caused by mismanagement by a board that lacks the experience to manage a utility. So I'm going to talk about how the bill addresses those three problems. The first is high rates. We don't have high rates because of the general fund transfer from the utility to the city. And in fact, the bill seems to recognize that. It seems to continue to require that this new board would provide a fund transfer of somewhere between 7% and 9% of the revenues from the utility to the city. Our current fund transfer is 7.97%. So it appears clear that the new board can't lower rates by lowering the general fund transfer. Our rates are high, as you heard from our commissioner, in large part because we have a 30-year fixed biomass contract. That's a contractual obligation. We also have implemented a lot of conservation methods and efforts, and we've also supported a lot of solar and green energy along with the declining consumption. But regardless of who governs the utility, that contractual obligation will continue to exist. It's not going away. Interestingly, the bill has several provisions that seem to allow this new board to void any past contract if they are presented with information that a previous member of the city may have had a conflict of interest. As your staff points out, that's unconstitutional. They can't do that. So this bill doesn't seem to address high energy rates in any respect. Does it address management? Again, this new board can't undo our existing contractual obligations. This board could do the same thing that my client's done for the past 3 years, which is aggressively try to lower the costs of running this utility by a series of refinancing, by restructuring utility staff, by cutting corners and efficiently managing the utility in every way that it can. Finally, will this bill create a new board that has more utilities experience? It won't. I think some of you have already read the requirements under this bill. It's a 4-year degree in any of a broad number of subjects, or you have to own a business with a certain number of sales. Under the bill, I'm qualified to be on the board of directors, and I assure you I'm not qualified to run a municipal utility. So the bill in my mind solves none of these purported problems that have been presented. But if it's passed, it will create a whole host of new problems, and I'm going to try to tick through those pretty quickly for you all. First is it's already having an effect on the city's search for a general manager for utilities. The city is trying to find a replacement for our interim. We've had to advise the candidates that if they do want to become employed with the city through this search process, and interviews are actually taking place today, that we can only enter into a contract with them for 1 year. Because this bill, if passed, obviously they can't continue to be a city employee after that point. Fundamentally, I don't know what this bill creates. It states it creates a nonprofit enterprise. It states it creates an independent entity. It states it creates a municipal entity, a cost-based enterprise, and a political subdivision. Those are 5 different things. It can't possibly create all of those in one board. Whatever it creates, it appears to be a taking. It requires the unrestricted transfer from the city to this new entity of all of our utility enterprises, not just our electric, all the property, all the assets, all the control. This new board, I'm concerned, with no fiduciary duty to the city and no accountability to the city commission or the electorate, even though the bill purports to continue to require a general fund transfer, I'm not sure that the board would have the either the legal obligation or the will to not try to lower electric utility rates through doing other things. And if the city cannot rely on a predictable annual transfer, the city commission, it appears, would be forced to raise our millage rate. And again, that's really significant in Gainesville, where only 40% of the property is on the tax roll. That means the cost burden would be borne by the owners of that property. Even if the commission went up to the statutory 10 mils, that would only raise 80% of what our utility transfer is, so we couldn't even be made whole. There's provisions in the bill for the general manager to serve as a non-voting member of this board. Obviously, then what that means is the general manager could never talk to the board members outside of a sunshine meeting. Imagine if you couldn't talk to your key staff person except in meetings just like this. The bill has extensive provisions, and by that I mean 1/10 of the substance of the bill, 44 lines, are devoted to indemnification of the board members, including advance payment of expenses, provision of private legal services, if there's some legal action or proceeding that involves the board. It just doesn't work like that. That's the wrong standard. Public officers in the state of Florida either have qualified immunity, absolute immunity or immunity when acting in the course and scope of their employment. What that means is they can't be sued. The entity has to step forward and defend them. So all of that part of the bill is just off base. Finally, the referendum question is misleading. Why do I tell you all of these infirmities? It's because what I imagine will happen is this bill will generate a lot of unnecessary litigation, either people challenging the referendum question, or certainly when the bill goes to be implemented, what has been created, what is the city required to transfer? Those are all unknown questions. And certainly also, as applied, it's going to create bond issues when this new entity tries to issue bonds. Are those bonds in the city's name? Would it affect the city's bond ratings? How about legal liability? Are our contracts even assignable? There may be challenges when it comes to that. And so finally, if this bill isn't a solution, what is? I've shared with both my client and with Representative Perry that there are many models throughout the state that we could emulate. And those models go anywhere from a strong advisory board to a complete independent authority. There's good models out there. This simply is not one. So if I can answer any questions for you, I'd be glad to.
Representative Goodson with a question.
Thank you, Chair. Could you tell me, madam, their rate of pay is going to be 60% of the salary of a city commissioner, correct?
That's correct.
You recognize.
What is this? Thank you.
Follow up.
What is the salary of a city commissioner now?
You're recognized.
$30,000, according to our commissioner.
You're recognized.
$30,000 plus insurance, plus travel, plus car allowance, plus what? What else?
You're recognized.
We have $3,000 travel. We have no car allowance. We don't
get one. Well, if the questions are going to be directed to commissioner, we might not mean to bring her back up, if you're willing.
Chair. Commissioner, I was looking for a number that was the total package that you earned by being a seated commissioner on the council. No,
I can see that, but I'm not so sure myself. But after you ask, I know we get a $3,000 travel package on top of the salary, and we do get the fringe benefits that the employees get, which is insurance and some retirement. I don't get retirement, but you can tell why.
Yes. Follow-up, sir?
Follow-up.
So would you... both of you standing there with the travel and the fringe benefits, could we say $35,000?
Sure.
Okay. So 60% of that now would be paid to five commissioners, correct?
Correct.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. $35,000.
Representative Broder, the question.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Over on the, there we go. As a longtime Gainesville resident, although not currently, this is an interesting issue to me. You've made mention of the fact that you believe that the utility rates are high because you have chosen to use alternative fuel sources. Is it your opinion that those fuel sources, and structure the question this way, is it your opinion that there are other fuel sources that could be used that would be cheaper?
You recognize.
It is my understanding that that's why when you compare our rates to the comparators, that our rates appear high now, because many of their power sources rely on natural gas, which is at an all-time low. Our power sources are different. We do also have coal power sources that can be used.
For follow-up?
Thank you. And so do you believe that right now there isn't a fiduciary problem that when there are lower rates available or other alternatives available that they're not choosing to use those?
You recognize.
I think the issue for us is we have a 30-year fixed contract that we have to take the power that the biomass plant generates. So we have been trying to make other power sales to other entities so that we could use our other power sources and generate some more revenue. There's been a very aggressive effort by our utilities management to do that. We've also been trying to get the University of Florida to become a customer, even more than they are now, of the utility services.
Follow up.
Thank you very much. And so to finish it out, then biomass is just a very expensive way to generate power.
You recognize?
It is at this time under our contract, but it may not always be, again, depending on how the rest turns out.
Thank you for your testimony today. And I just wanted to point out one quick thing, and you raised a lot of good points, and thanks for your expertise. Representative Fullwood with the question.
I apologize, Mr. Chair. I just had a question just so I understand the structure a little bit better. So right now, the City Commission is essentially the Board of Director, Board of Governors for the Utility Authority, and there is a general manager who is the Chief Executive Officer, essentially, or he's in charge of the day-to-day operations of the utility company, which includes water, electric, broadband, et cetera, et cetera. Is that how the structure is set up right now?
You recognize?
Yes, that is how the structure is set up. The general manager manages on a day-to-day basis all four of our utilities.
And just one follow-up, Mr. Chair, if I may. And that general manager reports to the board or gives a report every 2 weeks at a board meeting or reports to the chair or mayor of the city? Is that how it works?
You recognize?
Well, actually, in response to the chamber's report and things heard from the citizens, what our commission has done, you're correct. The general manager is a direct at-will report to the city commission. But what we've done now is one meeting each month that the city commission has, the whole afternoon session is devoted to utilities items and is devoted to receiving reports and having in-depth discussions about the utility matters.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Representative Raywinkle Vesalinda with the question.
Thank you, Chair. We're back here trying to compute how much money it would cost to do this. And so what I would like to be clear about is the staff of this new commission, is that included in the bill? Is it going to be using city commission staff? Where is the staff cost?
You recognize?
The bill appears to contemplate that somehow the city's current workforce that is assigned to the utilities, again, because we're all city employees, GRU currently is just a DBA of the city. The bill seems to contemplate that all of the current utilities employees would somehow be transferred over to this new entity, because there's some language about the employees who were formerly with the utility would not lose any of their benefits and that type of thing. I'm not sure how that's going to work out, because many of those employees are covered by collective bargaining units, and there are a lot of other, and obviously the city's pension plan. So again, just many unknowns in that front.
Okay. And I just want to point out, as I was saying, you mentioned that there was a provision that staff deemed unconstitutional. Well, thanks to their diligence and Rep. Perry for working with them, mm-hmm. Amendment 4 that we passed today does remove that provision, and I just wanted to make that clear.
Great.
Thank you. And thanks for your time today.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Okay, up next we have Susan Botcher from the City of Gainesville.
My name is Susan Botcher, and thank you so much, Mr. Chair and members of this committee, for allowing me this time to come speak. It has been wonderful to hear the dialogue and the intelligent questions that are being asked. I've been a resident of Gainesville and a GRU customer for 40 years. I'm also a former Gainesville City Commissioner. I am here to ask that you vote no on this bill. Our politically diverse Gainesville City Commission and the Alachua County Commission voted both unanimously to oppose this bill. And as my former colleague, Commissioner Hinson Rawls, pointed out, Representative Clovis Watson, who is the chair of the Alachua County Legislative Delegation, also opposes this bill. The idea that an independent governance board is needed stems from the complaints, as you've heard, that GRU rates are the highest in the state, and that the City Commission, as the governing board of the utility, is not being responsive to its customers. Our utility has a tiered rate system, and contrary to these accusations of the highest rates, GRU's first two tiers, which all GRU customers pay at, is at the state average. And only 16% of the households that are GRU customers pay into that higher tier. So everybody pays the first two bottom, and if you use more than a certain amount of power, then that excess power, you fall into that higher rate. So this claim that we have the highest rates in the state is actually a distortion of the truth. makes for good headlines, but it's not the truth. This system gives our customers an incentive to be mindful of their use of electricity and to take personal responsibility for controlling their own utility costs. This bill threatens that. The one factor that's been blamed, and you've heard about this, for high rates is the contract the city signed in 2009 to purchase power from the Gainesville Renewable Energy Center, or GREC, G-R-E-C, that uses locally produced woody biomass as its fuel. GREC is privately owned, and the city has contracted to purchase 100% of the power it generates. Incidentally, the Chamber of Commerce in 2009 endorsed this contract and the move toward this renewable power because they recognized that locally produced fuel means local jobs, and this has added hundreds of jobs to the area and has benefited our local economy. Construction on the plant began in the summer of 2011, and GREC went online in December of 2013. Utility rates were not impacted by this prior to that date. So any claim that we historically have had or for years we have had the highest rate just isn't accurate. It wasn't until after the city signed the contract with GREC that the U.S. economy began its steep decline and natural gas prices began to plummet. This put upward pressure on GRE's rates. In 2013, the Chamber issued its Energy Study Report, which made recommendations about lowering rates, reducing the general fund transfer, and for a governance system to be created that would include representation of utility ratepayers who live outside the city limits. Our City Commission and utility took immediate steps to mitigate the rates and to address the Chamber's recommendations. Overall rates have been reduced due to a number of deliberate actions taken by GRU management and at the direction of the City Commission. The general fund transfer, as you, City Attorney Shalley told you, has been drastically reduced. I've told you about this because it demonstrates that when customers have spoken, the elected city commissioners have responded. The current system of governance has been working. Good decisions were made by the city. When outside factors caused these good decisions to turn problematic, the elected officials took action and continue to take action in the best interest of GRU customers. And as you know, as elected officials, if your constituents do not feel you're doing a good job, they will vote you out of office. This bill will prevent that from happening. The appointed utility commissioners cannot be voted out of office. I oppose House Bill 1325 for many reasons. One is because I believe this is a local issue, and we can, will, and have been working on out a local solution. But if for no other reason, I oppose this bill because it will render our citizens voiceless. It will eliminate all checks and balances, and it would make it impossible for citizens or any city, county, or state officials to remove from office any member of the proposed Utilities Commission for any reason. This does not serve the public well. Please vote no on this bill. And I would like to add one final thing. The question that I think you were asking, Representative Broder, about using different power sources. GRU has a very diversified power energy portfolio. Coal, natural gas. For a little while, we did have some nuclear before we got out of the Crystal River 3 situation. Certainly now biomass, solar, and I think we still may do a little bit of methane, I guess it is, from landfill. So we have a very diversified fuel source. And at any time on the spot market, biomass can actually be less expensive than coal. So it's not an easy kind of claim to make that biomass is the most expensive and therefore that's why our rates are high. That's just not accurate. So anyway, please vote no on this bill, and I thank you again for your time.
Thank you, Ms. Botcher, for your testimony today. And up next, we have Teresa Sperling Wood, who is also a citizen of the city of Gainesville.
Good afternoon. Thank you for allowing me to speak. I am Teresa Sperling Wood of Gainesville, Florida, and have worked for over 3 decades in the energy, public, and private sectors. Rate increases are not unique to Gainesville. Utility rates are going up across the country due to a combination of factors that include flattening demand and sales, increased costs of extraction and delivery of fossil fuels, which is a volatile marketplace. Our diverse utility portfolio is a benefit to our community. This bill would do away with our aggressive conservation and energy efficiency programs and programs that help our most vulnerable citizens reduce their bills. The Chamber report claims high commercial rates are making Gainesville less competitive. However, Gainesville is named number one city on the rise in 2013, 2014 top best 100 places for business and careers, Forbes, 2014 number two leading metros for economic and job growth in Florida, and many others. Utility rates are not the sole determining factor when deciding where to locate a business, move your family, or retire. Gainesville has been nationally recognized on many levels for its innovative and forward-thinking utility practices, as has Tallahassee. And we have the same city's policies. Please oppose this bill. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony today. Up next, we have Nancy Darren from the City of Gainesville.
Thank you very much. My name is Nancy Darren. I've lived in Gainesville for 19 years and have a small business. I took time off today to urge you to oppose this bill. It imposes a micromanaged solution for a problem that doesn't exist and is an insult to the city and citizens of Gainesville. I would point out that our city and our county commissions unanimously oppose this bill, as does our legislative delegation chair, Representative Clovis Watson. This bill imposes a governance structure that is narrowly focused and inflexible. It would claim absolute power over our city-owned utility with no accountability to anyone but itself. It usurps our authority as citizens and undermines our commissioners' ability to govern responsibly and retain flexibility necessary to deal with the increasingly complex economic and environmental challenges that lie ahead. It does away with policies and practices that have made us a successful city. It doesn't reflect our capability and character as a university city that attracts national recognition on many fronts, including accolades for our utility. We have much to be proud of. We don't need a bill from Tallahassee to tell us how to govern our city and our utility. We're already taking responsibility to address governance improvements locally. Commissioners have a fiduciary responsibility to set policy and oversee the management of GRU on citizens' behalf, and must maintain control over the business of the city, of which GRU is an integral part. Our city commissions, past and present, have been responsive to ideas, concerns, and criticisms offered by citizens and our Chamber of Commerce about issues such as coal plants, biomass, and rates. For over a year and a half, with a great deal of community input, we have been actively moving forward with addressing current policies and procedures that need improvement or revision, and exploring different governance structures that include an active advisory board to review and make recommendations to the City Commission on GRU matters. This bill designates a small appointed committee comprised of only business and commercial concerns, yet 90% of our utility customers are residential. It's not reflective of our community with a broad and diverse range of expertise. Our community should get to decide the composition, the members of any advisory committee that that we should choose. I am deeply disturbed by the predetermined and inflexible nature of this bill and how it erects barriers between our city commission, our utility, and our ratepayers. With 60% of properties off the tax rolls, GRU is a core city asset and an integral part of our strategic planning. We obviously have the capability and capacity to exercise good governance and policy at our local level. Please oppose this bill. Thank you.
Thank you. Up next, we have Rob Brinkman from the City of Gainesville.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chair and representatives. My name is Rob Brinkman, and I appreciate the opportunity to speak to you all today. As a 20-year citizen of Gainesville, I have long been engaged on local environmental issues with a particular focus on energy. Indeed, I served as chair of the Gainesville Energy Advisory Committee to the City Commission for a number of years, as well as a number of other local government committees. As such, I am very familiar with the issues that surround our utility that have culminated in the bill before you. I traveled here today to speak in opposition to the bill, which I would describe as a solution in search of a problem. But let me tell you about a couple of other options that were considered before the biomass plant. About 13 years ago, GRU engaged in an integrated resource plan, which proposed a new 220 megawatt coal, petroleum coke, and biomass power plant. The plant was going to be capable of burning them all. If it had after due diligence, including a report by an outside consultant, they spent about $350,000 and took a year to make sure of what they were doing, the City Commission declined to approve the project. If it had adopted it, it would have spent at least tens of millions of dollars designing and engineering and attempting to permit a coal plant. Well, history has shown that you don't get a coal plant approved anymore. So they saved that money. Then our utility presented a choice to the Gainesville City Commission between a partnership on the Levy Nuclear Project or a local biomass project. Again, the City Commission, on the recommendation of GRU staff, chose wisely not to invest in the Levy County Nuclear Project, which has since been canceled. Also, our utility recently negotiated terms paying Gainesville about $10 million for its very limited ownership interest in the Crystal River Nuclear Plant. The big benefit of this is it absolves the City of Gainesville from all liability of decommissioning and spent fuel storage costs. I bring these two up, not because I'm anti-nuclear by any means, but just to show of the wisdom of the decisions. And in fact, those two failed nuclear power projects of now Duke Energy have cost ratepayers of that company approximately $3.5 billion, according to press reports. That is more money than GRU will pay the owner of the biomass plant for 30 years of power from a 100 megawatt plant. The projected 30-year output is about 23 terawatts or 23 trillion watts. So that's what Gainesville's buying for its $3.5 billion. The ratepayers of Duke got nothing. So that basically is why I'm here. I do not agree with the contention that GRU is a mismanaged utility. We, as a city, as a community, have chosen to invest in the things that we hold important, and that's the way it should be. That is a democracy. The citizens elect the commission, which makes the policy decisions and directs staff to do it. That's what I think should continue, and I ask this legislature to respect the citizens of Gainesville and their right to determine the future of their community and their utility. Please oppose HB 1325. Thank you.
Thank you for your time today, Mr. Brinkman. Up next, we have Mary Vaughn Davinsky.
Good afternoon, and thank you very much for listening to us. We came from Gainesville to speak to you about this issue because we care about Gainesville and how we live in the city. I'm here as a citizen of Gainesville and as a GRU consumer, and I want to speak as such. I'm also an environmentalist, and I care about conserving energy very much. So the reason I'm here today is to ask you to keep the GRU governance with the City of Gainesville and to oppose this bill. GRU has been under the city governance for 100 years, And at this time, this utility company has a mix of energy sources like biomass, coal, natural gas, solar, which is, I think, a very smart way to diversify the way we can produce energy in Gainesville. So if the city of Gainesville has done such a good job for 100 years, I do not think that it is appropriate at this time to totally change the way GRU is governed. And I feel personally also that there is a certain amount of confusion that maybe some people can play on between bills and rates. I moved to Gainesville 7 years ago from South Florida, where FPL was providing my electricity. When you move to Gainesville, you're going to get a high bill from GRU because the bill is going to cover your electricity, your gas, your water treatment, as well as your garbage. So, you know, people are so busy working, taking the kids to school and other places that sometimes you just don't read all the fine print in a bill, and you're just happy to pay that bill. So in many ways, GRU is very competitive with the past bills that I had from FPL regarding the electricity. So GRU may have some issues, but there are very smart people in Gainesville. There is a lot of environmentalists, a lot of experts in many ways. So please let the governance of GRU be under the City Commission. We have very good commissioners there. And as you know, the City and the County Commission, as well as Mr. Clovis Watson, are opposing this bill. So please oppose this bill for us too. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Vinsky. Up next, we have Kamal Latham with Gainesville Area Chamber of Commerce.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm Kamal Latham, Vice President for Public Policy, Gainesville Area Chamber of Commerce. The chamber has been referenced several times during these proceedings, and I wanted to just provide an opportunity to provide some facts and information of what the chamber's position is and what the chamber has done. First off, I just want to say for the record that I'm here speaking to provide information to this body. For background on the chamber, we represent over 1,300 businesses in the Gainesville region. Collectively, these entities employ over 70,000 individuals. We do have a vision for the Gainesville region to be the global hub of talent, innovation, and opportunity. One thing that we do desire is to see lower utility rates in the Gainesville region. About 2 years ago, the chamber decided to launch an energy study group because we saw factually that Gainesville ranked amongst the highest in the state of Florida in terms of utility rates. The information that we're pulling from is from the Florida Municipal Electric Association, FMEA. If you go to the website, www.publicpower.com, you will see the rankings, you will see the bar chart indicating that Gainesville, at least over the last 2 years, has had amongst the highest rates in the state of Florida, residential and commercial. We launched this study group about 2 years ago, and it was chaired by former State Representative David Flagg, who was also a former mayor commissioner in the city of Gainesville. The vice chair was Dr. David Denslow, a prominent economist from the University of Florida. And also in the audience, we have former State Representative Perry McGriff, who's also former county commissioner, former Gainesville mayor commissioner, who was also a member of our energy study group. So two individuals who served in the body that you currently serve now, along with 10 other individuals, spent over 7 months with deliberating and analyzing and reviewing a number of different issues regarding Gainesville regional utilities. And one of them was governance. We had a lot of debate, we had a lot of deliberation. We had over 35 meetings, public and private. We consulted with members of the City Commission, members of the County Commission. We wanted to get thoughts and views about how can we strengthen one of the best assets that we have in the City of Gainesville, Gainesville Region Utilities. And when we looked at the different governance models in the state of Florida, based on information that we received from the Florida Municipal Electric Association, we realized there's several different models. One is city commission model, another one is an appointed utility authority, another one is an elected utility authority. When we looked and we compared the rates, we were able to have information from the Florida Municipal Electric Association that showed when you compare Gainesville to the five appointed utility authorities currently in the state of Florida, Fort Pierce, New Smyrna Beach, Jacksonville, Kissimmee, Orlando, these are utilities that are larger than GRU and smaller than GRU. GRU ranked higher, significantly higher, in utility rates based on this public information than the other appointed utility authorities in the state of Florida. It's not a new thing to have an appointed utility authority with fiduciary responsibility in the state of Florida. We did recommend that such an authority be created to govern Gainesville Regional Utilities. We also looked at information, Mr. Chairman, from the American Public Power Association, APPA, which is the association that represents municipal utilities in the United States. There are about 2,000 municipal utilities in the United States, Mr. Chairman. And in 2010, the American Public Power Association, they conducted a governance survey. And when they did this governance survey, you can see this pie chart here. When you have more than 90,000 customers, if you are a municipal utility, those that have responded to the survey, 77% of public utilities responded to the APPA survey said that they have a utility board, not a city commission that governs them. When you have less than 5,000 customers, the numbers are inverted. GRU has over 93,000 customers. And so when you look nationwide, what do the other municipal utilities that have over 90,000 customers, and there are about 33 out of the 2,000 municipal utilities in the United States have over 90,000 customers, two-thirds of, actually 75% of them, have a utility governance model that is a board, not a city commission. And so what we looked at, it's hard to improve when you have no one but yourself to follow. If you look at Gainesville within a fishbowl, there certainly is a lot of views back and forth of what is the best way to govern the utility. But when we see that we had some of the highest rates in the state and some of the highest rates in the nation, and we see that other utilities that are of similar size and complexity to GRU nationwide have opted to go with a utility board to govern their affairs, there is a reason for this. When you have five different lines of business as GRU, over $400 million in revenue, over one-third of your, but one-third of your customers are outside the city limits. That is a complicated operation, and we believe that you need to have a separate, dedicated board of individuals who can spend their time on this. We commend our city commission. We commend our legislative delegation that has decided to take on this issue head on, because this is a challenge for our community, and we need a solution. The solution, ladies and gentlemen, is that we need to have the citizens of Gainesville need to vote. There needs to be a ballot referendum for the citizens of Gainesville to determine if they want to have a utility authority to govern GRU. This is not something that could just be decided by the city commission. This is not something that could just be decided by the state legislature. But there are only three ways that you can put an initiative on the ballot. The city commission can put it on the ballot, a petition from citizens could put it on the ballot, and the state legislature can put it on the ballot. And so we would like to encourage this body to consider an opportunity that your action could potentially put something on the ballot that gives the citizens the opportunity to vote. Now, at the end of the day, if the city commission wanted to put forward a utility model which would have full fiduciary responsibility, that is something that we would be excited about. If there are citizens who put forward a petition that would be able to put something like this type of initiative on the ballot, that is something that we'd be excited about. Right now, we're only aware at this point in time that out of those three options, this option, the state route, is the option that's currently in play. At this point, the chamber is just providing information. We want to just clarify the record in terms of what our report had put forward. In your staff analysis, you'll see a reference to our 77-page report with the details that you can find. We thank you for this opportunity. The chamber officially, right now, we do not have a position for or against HB 1325. However, we do support the legislature putting the question of should you have independent appointed utility authority to govern Gainesville Regional Utilities, that question should be put on the ballot. The citizens, and only the citizens, must have the opportunity to decide. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Latham. We have a question here from Representative Williams. Am I saying your name correctly?
Yes.
Thank you, Ms. Latham. It's good to see you again. Since we're just dealing with the referendum piece, I noticed that online, I think it's 533 of the bill, it talks about the next presidential preference primary as the time when you would vote. Do you think it would probably be a better, what's your thoughts on having it at that presidential primary, preference primary, or at a time where you would probably get a greater swath, if you will, of voters, say, at the general election? What's your thoughts on that?
Sir, that's
a— You recognize.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Sir, that is a very good question. We don't have any thoughts on that. At this point, the chamber has not taken a specific position on HB 1325, so therefore we don't have a specific thought about when a referendum should be held. We do support, to be clear, a special legislative act by the Florida legislature that would put that question of whether or not you should have an independent appointed utility authority to govern Gainesville Regional Utilities, that question should be placed on the ballot.
For a follow-up.
Thank you. And so not referring to any particular legislation that may or may not be moving before this body, when, from a chamber's perspective, when do you think would be the best or most opportune time to have such a legislative act that would require a referendum put before the voters?
You recognize.
That is a very good question, which is a good political science question. We have not conducted that sort of a political analysis as of this point. But thank you for the question, sir.
Representative Fullwood for a question.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I haven't had a chance to review your report, but curious, you suggest an independent board. Does your report say the board should be compensated or a volunteer board?
You recognize.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. In our report, we did recommend that the board be not compensated.
If I may clarify, you said not compensated?
Correct.
Okay. But okay, that's not a question for you, but I think the bill addresses compensation, but your report says no compensation.
Yes, sir.
All right, thank you.
Okay, thank you for your testimony today. We certainly appreciate it.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
All right, up next we have Bill Peebles, representing Gainesville. And Mr. Peebles, we are, clock's ticking, so if you could just keep it to the point, obviously. Thank you.
Was that an invitation, Mr. Chairman?
I'm sorry?
Was that an invitation?
No, sir.
Is it on? I'm Bill Peebles. I represent the city of Gainesville, and I had not planned to speak on this bill, but I want to just clarify some of the things that the last speaker said. The chamber did recommend an independent board, but the independent board they recommended looked at nothing like the one that's embodied in Representative Perry's bill. And as for the idea that there ought to be a referendum and there's only one way to have it held, and that is for you to have it held, I would suggest to you that if this bill only required a referendum, that'd be a very different situation. In fact, I can't imagine that my client would object to a referendum, but I think in their view, a referendum is only going to delay resolution of the issue because my client is engaged constantly in seeking to determine the proper way to provide for a different governance model for this utility. And so the effect of Representative Perry's bill is going to be to put that off for a while and actually prolong the achievement of the overall goal of creating some different governance model for this utility. And so I just, again, would like to reiterate that the issue about this bill is not whether there'll be a referendum. The issue is the way this commission is set up is going to create, as the lawyer said, more litigation than you can imagine. And that's all. Thank you. Questions?
Thank you, Mr. Peebles. We have a question from Rep. Williams.
Thank you so much. Two quick questions. So, how close do you think the city of Gainesville is to taking the recommendations of that blue ribbon panel to create the new governance model?
You recognize.
Representative, I don't know how close they are to that model. I know that they're close to a model. And as Commissioner Henson Rawls told you, they've looked at Jacksonville Electric Authority. They've looked at Orlando Utilities Commission. They've looked at a model that's worked for a long time in Lakeland, where they had an outside customer representation issue. And they are circling up on a solution to this problem.
You recognize follow-up?
You brought up something that I hadn't even thought of when you mentioned it about potential litigation. With this legislative proposal that's before us by our colleague, if it passes, go to referendum, it passes the voters, litigation occurs, what's your opinion, and expert opinion, being an attorney, who would cover those costs? Would it then fall back to the city commission? Would it fall back to the electric utility?
You recognize?
Representative Williams, my guess is everybody's going to get sued, and everybody's going to go hire their own lawyers. And as a consequence, it'll be good for the Gainesville Bar Association and probably outside attorneys. But I can't imagine that there wouldn't be duplicate lawyers on each side. If the litigation involved actions taken by the new commission, then the new commission obviously will have to respond, but the old commission will have to respond, or the city commission will have to respond as well as the original party to the contracts that are likely to be challenged. Lots of lawyers.
Thank you, Mr. Peebles.
Thank you.
Okay, members, Vice Chair Bashirs has made a motion to reconsider Amendment 1. Are there any objections to the motion? Seeing no objections, show the motion adopted. Vice Chair Bashirs has offered an amendment to Amendment Number 1. You're recognized to explain your amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This amendment here basically clears up in Amendment 1, lines 25 through 29, and makes it very clear that you cannot be convicted of a felony in order to serve on this board. That is the amendment, sir.
Are there any questions for Representative Bashirs on the amendment to the amendment? Seeing no questions, public comment? No public comment. Debate? Seeing no debate, is there any objection? Seeing no objection, show the amendment to the amendment adopted. We are now back on Amendment 1 as amended. Are there questions on the amendment? Public comment? Debate? Would you like to close on Amendment 1 once again?
Thank you for taking care of that. Thank you.
Okay, any objection to the amendment? Without objection, show the amendment once again adopted. We are now back on the bill as amended, and now we're in debate. Sorry, I didn't see your card, and of course, you're more than welcome. Please just fill one out.
I registered online. I have it with me.
Okay. State your name, please. Thanks.
My name is Jim Connish, and I have had the privilege of working at the PSC. I digested all PSC decisions in electric and telecommunications between 1965 and 1979. I started publishing the Florida Public Service Commission Reporter in 1981. I started publishing the Florida Administrative Law Reports in 1984. I began the Environmental and Land Use Administrative Law Reporter in 1988, as well as the Florida Department of Revenue Tax Reporter. So I have probably an unparalleled knowledge of the substantive law governing this utility. I'm also a residential landlord that has mastered metered historic buildings, and I pass about $40,000 a year worth of GRU bills onto my tenants where their contract deems this additional rent, and I've seen the suffering. GRU is the fifth largest municipally owned multi-utility in Florida. One-third of their customers are outside the city limits. City of Gainesville elections are held in the spring. We just had one March 17th. It featured a 12% turnout. At a presidential preference primary in March 2016, we expect double the turnout because there'll be no incumbent president. Both parties will try to be fielding presidential candidates when the usually standalone City of Gainesville elections are held. So that would be a high turnout election. The largest consumer of electricity in our community is the University of Florida. Their contract with Duke is expiring. They will not even negotiate with the City of Gainesville because of the city commissioners and the way they've mismanaged this utility. They're not even talking to them. They're thinking about building their own power plant, even though we're sitting on massive excess base load. That's how bad it is. Since 2000, our nonpartisan so-called city elections has been hijacked by partisan politics. Candidates elected took loyalty oaths to their party bosses before they began their campaigns, a tactic that would cause a county judge to be thrown out of the Florida bar. This partisan group has presided over a situation where last year 13,000 plus customers were disconnected 19,000 plus times, generating at least an additional $1.3 million for the utility. That's 13% of the customers. In addition to the sky-high electric bills, we have bundling and illegal tying of stormwater and garbage to the electric meter in violation of the antitrust laws, water, wastewater, and then we pile on top of that a Bernie Madoff 166231 utility tax scheme that's being assailed in the local county court by myself, and I would refer you to the grutaxrefund.org website to see this case of first impression, which challenges how they've jacked the 10% maximum rate up to as high as 16% through a variety of schemes and tactics involving pyramiding. While this group has controlled GRU, GRU debt also has soared by 600% to $1.2 billion. Even though we did not need any more base load until at least 2022, in 2009, the city contracted to buy all the power from a biomass power plant, and that deal was to be kept secret for 32 years. Citizens sued, had the contract redacted, and we found out what was done. As soon as the contract was signed, in violation of its own ordinances, the city began overcharging us for fuel, building up an unauthorized and unprecedented $32 million levelization fund to mask the impact of this biomass contract that was supposed to be kept secret. This fund is exhausted at the end of the year, and the highest utility rates in the state of Florida will rise even more. Moreover, our coal-fired power plant is being compromised because it's not being used for the base load function it was designed for, and that's deteriorating the most valuable asset the city has. The city says they need the utility to diversify its revenue, but if you look at the utility tax and if you look at the gaudy transfer payment, which is one of the highest in the country, over 50% of their budget comes directly from the utility, not to mention the way the utility is used as a political ATM to make transfer payments that do not go through the city coffers. There's a number of misinformations that were held out, and I want to like point those out. The city attorney, as she well knows, overlooked the fact that the bill puts a floor on the transfer payment of 7%. So the idea that the city won't get money is not true. The bill provides for 80% of city commission salaries for the utility members, not 60%. The bill does not.
I don't want to cut you off. I know you're a proponent of the bill, and we still have debate. So in interest of time, you may want to come to a close.
I'm going to just wrap up real quick.
All right.
The bill does not change the city charter. It merely allows a referendum vote to be decided on by the electors. The current city commission will never put anything on the ballot because the city charter requires a 6/7 majority to get something on the ballot. Finally, in the city charter currently, there is language that makes any contract voidable if there's city conflict of interest. They didn't mention they have a $350,000 forensic audit that's coming out of the wash any day now. So any contract that's tainted by conflict of interest is voidable now, and this bill does not change that. I would advise you to understand the depth of the despair that we face in Gainesville and to allow the voters to choose on a different, qualified, depoliticized group of people to protect us from the city commission. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Members, we're now in debate on the bill. Representative Ray Winkle Basilinda.
Thank you, Chair. I usually vote for local bills because I think that the reps know their communities well and our representatives are colleagues, but there is not a unanimity on this bill from the Gainesville delegation, so I was concerned about that. I'm also concerned about that ethics section that I had questions about, wondering about the waiver and the request for a waiver and would like to get some more information about that. I think that the citizens who've traveled up here don't seem to want this, and I think if they decide later on, or if the community decides later on that they do want this, I think there could be a referendum on the at the local level. And additionally, I've looked at Gainesville as an oasis of innovation and doing things in the energy sphere that the rest of the state has seemed paralyzed to do. And so I don't want to do anything that might squelch that innovation. It's been an there has been testimony today that there may that may exactly happen. So for a number of these reasons, I'm going to vote against the bill. I think that you and I had a conversation, Representative Perry, and I appreciate you calling me and giving the us the opportunity to talk about it. And I did say that if I saw anything that might squelch innovation, that might keep the paralysis in the state going about energy innovation, that would be something that would make me vote against this bill. But these other things I didn't expect, and they've come up, and so I'm going to regretfully have to vote against this bill, but thank you very much.
Other debate? Members in debate. Representative Broder.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think clearly there are some things going on here. Dr. Denslow, who authored that report, was my economics professor, and since then he's been quoted in about 50 worldwide publications, so I think the findings are probably fairly legitimate that something needs to be looked at in order to help give some relief to the residents. I understand a handful were here today, but that's certainly not the majority of Gainesville residents, and so I don't understand what would be wrong with a referendum. Is this particular structure absolutely correct? Probably could use a little bit of tweaking, but that's what we have the committee process for. We've got more committees, we've got the floor, we've got the Senate. There's some other things left that we can do to get this right, but I don't see any reason to stop it today. Thank you.
Other debate. Rep. Williams, debate.
First of all, I want to thank Representative Perry for bringing forth this lively discussion on local utility governance. I have some concern as to the referendum timing of it, and was almost ready to offer an amendment to make sure that we have as many folks as possible, if this is going to pass, to have an opportunity to vote on it. I'm going to work with Representative Perry to see if we can maybe move that to a general election. I think it's important that, as I think the last speaker pointed out, the presidential primary, you probably got double the participation. I would venture to guess in a state like Florida, and in a community like Gainesville, you would probably get three or four times the participation, and that's what you really want when you have a decision of this magnitude, when you're dealing with the utility and the utility rates of citizens of a community. So I'm gonna work with Representative Perry to hopefully see if we can change that and look at a general election. And then, you know, it may throw off, but maybe by then it may not even be necessary. I heard the representative from Gainesville, the lobbyists for Gainesville, talk about that they're pretty close. And I hope that they would take the recommendations that Mr. Latham brought from the chamber as well. But hopefully the citizens who aren't members of the chamber would also have an opportunity to weigh in and look at it from that point. The chamber brought up a good point about making this a non-paid board. That's important too. I don't think any of us want to expand government any further than what it is right now. And so hopefully we can work on those provisions as well. I think what Representative Broder brought up are some valid points. And I'm glad that he allowed Representative Broder to get out of his class and with a passing grade. But nonetheless, those are some of the concerns I have. Thank you.
Rep. Goodson in debate.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I have concerns with the bill. I can't imagine, this is the first time I know of that the state has written a charter for a local government, when I would have thought that the city and the county would have got together with their attorneys, with meetings, public meetings, with people to talk about this and write it. Also, I'm concerned about the fact you have to have $5 million to run for this board. If that be the case, some of us probably wouldn't be elected here, you know. And also, with a scholarly degree in accounting, law, business, and similar fields of experience. That's going to limit people that might serve on this board, in my opinion. I just find that hard to believe. But if the sponsor thinks he can fix some of these issues before it gets to the floor, then I will vote today, but hold my vote finally on the floor. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Other debate? And just want to echo some of the concerns. Thank you, first of all, Representative Perry, for working with us, working with staff. I know this bill came to our committee pretty quickly, and you were amenable to some suggestions, and I know that in the interest of time, you're still looking to work on some other things. Obviously, we heard a litany of concerns, and I have some myself, but an interest in moving this forward and your commitment to work on it, I think that we can get there and do some good things. So I look forward to moving this forward today, but look forward to working with you as we go through the committee process going forward. But with that, you're welcome to close on your bill.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you to committee. This is for a local bill. Obviously, it took a lot more time and effort than you might have imagined. And I thank all the people from Gainesville and who traveled around. Certainly, the number of people traveling is a small representation of what would eventually vote. But I do take all of your comments seriously, and we'll look at each one of those. Representative Williams, I do want to look at the date. Our goal is to get the highest turnout and the most participation. Representative Ray Vasalinda, when you mentioned about the city and the efforts that have been made, I agree with you 100% on the goal of what we've done. There's always unintended consequences with consequences. Having 13,000 of our citizens disconnected, 13,000 disconnected. You know those are not the people who live in the nice neighborhoods. Those are not the people that can afford to have this. So those are the most vulnerable people that we have. I won't go through a litany. You've heard a lot of things. It's like a doomsday thing. We do have an independent board of the airport. We also have an independent library board that works pretty well. One point, I will bring up just a couple of points. One was talking about a Latrobe General Hospital that had an independent board, and they sold the hospital for $1 to develop that. This does not allow that board to do that. We were careful to put in checks and balances. This is a city asset. This does not change the ownership of this board. All it does is takes the city commission to appoint a board to manage this. If they sell assets, more than 5%, what we did is they can get rid of antiquated and unused equipment. They can sell that up to 5%. That money goes straight to the city commission, into the city coffers. Anything over that they would have to, you would have to require city commission approval. So we tried to put in checks and balances. There may be some more that we need to work on, but this is a serious issue with the most vulnerable people in our city and our county, and we cannot continue to put those people in this position. There's just lots of other things. Not like I say, I won't go through all of them. There's a lot of them. This kind of doomsday approach that we're going to have litigation. This has happened in other places around the state, and it's happened in Gainesville again with the library board and with the airport board that are independent in what they do. I would like to point out that the chamber's board that met, this study group, the two past state representatives were both Democrat state representatives. This is not a partisan issue, and Dr. Denslow, professor at the University of Florida, also not a partisan issue. This is simply an issue trying to simply give the voters, not two or three or five or 10 that came up to Tallahassee, to give the voters in Gainesville a chance for them to decide. It's in this bill, you heard the chamber not supporting the bill. They support the thing. They said they're not going to take a position on this. This is not to do something for the Chamber of Commerce. This is not to do something for any business or any specific specialty group. This is to give the voters who supposedly own the municipal, that's the title, give them a chance to say, yes, we want to do this, or no, we don't. That's what it does. The voters a chance. Thank you. We're going to continue to work. We have some great recommendations that have come up, and I appreciate you working with us, and we're going to continue to work with all the representatives. So thank you.
Thank you, Rep. Perry. Having closed on the bill, Ms. McCloskey, please call the roll.
Representatives Beshears?
Yes.
Broder?
Yes.
Dudley?
No.
Fullwood?
No.
Goodson? Hill,
yes.
Hudson,
yes.
LaRosa,
yes.
Nunez, Rewinkle Vasalinda,
no.
Rodriguez, Williams,
yes.
Chair Eagle.
Yes.
Passes.
By your vote, members, please show the bill passes. Thank you for your time today, Rep. Perry, and everyone who traveled to be here. We certainly appreciate it. And members, with that, that is, as of now, this is the last time we'll be meeting. I will certainly miss you, but look forward to working with you through the process. And with the early session next year, we'll be back at it pretty quickly. So I'll bring your ideas to the table. We'll get back to work. With that, Vice Chair Beshears moves to rest.